Ratcliffe has come to us from the UK. He was born close to Liverpool, a name very closely related with four mop-top kids in the 60s. He was born in the 40s, however, and during his early school years, his time was swallowed up by his obsession with New Orleans jazz and folk blues. He found Chris Barber's jazz band, which is still going, right? Chris is still around over there. And he was reproducing jazz from New Orleans, and Barber's banjoist, Lonnie Donegan, created the skiffle music, which created the big hit Rock Island Line and some other things over in Europe. Phil saw Donegan many times, had him autograph his five-string banjo, and he went to Liverpool's Cavern Club, where he saw Sonny Terry and Brownie McGee, Big Bill Brunzi, Muddy Waters, Sister Rosetta Tharpe, as well as, a year or two later, these four young mop-top guys based on insects. Phil was also interested in the natural world and pursued a career as an ecologist, doing his PhD, which is where he got the doctor part from, on the red deer, which is a species related to American elk. Around 1970, he picked up an Origin Jazz Library LP featuring Mississippi Blues. The music was superb. Robert Johnson, we heard about this morning, Skip James, Charlie Patton, and Mississippi John Hurt's 1928 recording of Stacco Lee Blues was featured and made an indelible impression. Nearly three decades later, he attended the first Mississippi John Hurt Festival in Avalon in 2003. Spent 3 days around Avalon, met friends and relatives of Hurt's. He was astonished to hear that no one had told Mississippi John Hurt's story. Decided he would do so, and he did in a book which he'll be talking about. Over the next 5 years, he visited Mississippi on numerous occasions, toured the East Coast from Vermont to Georgia, tracking down the folk who had known Mississippi John Hurt. This led to the discovery of some unreleased recordings, which is what he's going to talk about today. And you should all have handouts, or they're on the chairs, so you can follow along. One of the names that you'll recognize, longtime ARSC members, be the name Rockwell, Tommy Rockwell. I don't know if you knew that Tommy's son, Malcolm, has been a longtime ARSC member and lives in Hawaii, and his specialty is Hawaiian music, and he hopefully will come to the next one we do on the West Coast. So there's a small ARSC connection there, too. Bill?
Thank you. Okay, good evening. Afternoon. Is it evening? Afternoon. We've only just got into Kansas City and not sure what time it is, you know? So first I'd like to just say a quick thank you to the association for presenting me with an award for my book. It's very kind of you to do so, and also very kind of you to invite me to give this presentation today. The handout kind of follows the slides, so I hope that'll help you follow things through and maybe take something home to kind of remember what I've been talking about. My biography covers much of the social context of John Hurt's life. It talks a lot about life in rural Mississippi in the 1920s and 30s and 40s. Today I'm going to try and supplement this information by sharing with you some important recordings that I think significantly enhance our knowledge and appreciation of Mississippi John Hurt. I'm going to skip through the biographical stuff because essentially most of that's published in the book, and I wanted to concentrate particularly at a conference like this on the sound recordings. But interestingly, John Hurt's mother and father were both slaves, released after the end of the Civil War, and this is a marriage bond which I found for Isom Hurt and Mary Jane McCain, who were the two slave parents of Mississippi John Hurt. An interesting little bit of trivia is that Mary Jane McCain, like many slaves, took her name, her family name, from the slave owner. She was owned by a gentleman by the name of William Alexander McCain on the McCain plantation just northeast of Greenwood, Mississippi. And it turns out that William Alexander McCain was in fact the great-grandfather of somebody you all know as Senator John McCain. So in fact, Senator John McCain's great-grandfather actually owned Mississippi John Hurt's father. So there's a curious little bit of information. Shortly after John was born, he was the last of 10 children. And shortly after that, they moved from Teoc, near the McCain plantation, a few miles north to a little place called Avalon, Mississippi, which, as you'll hear later, became absolutely crucial in the clue to tracking down John Hurt many, many more years later. This slide shows Mary Jane McCain with seven of her children, John at the very bottom here, born in 1892. Interestingly, three of the family members had gone, but more interestingly, Isom was not there anymore. Isom didn't move to Avalon with the family, and John never knew his father. And in fact, it turns out that it looks very much as if Isom actually wasn't John Hurt's father anyway. So skip on a few years. John learned the guitar at a very early age and pestered his mother to buy him a guitar, which she did for $1.50, and he began to learn the guitar from local people. Two of his neighbors in the hill country above Avalon were these two guys, Willie Narmore, the fiddle player, and Shel Smith, the guitarist. These were close neighbors of John, and they played a lot of hillbilly music, which influenced John. What really was the breakthrough for John is that Willie Narmore had visited a fiddle contest in nearby Winona, Mississippi, and won a prize. And a gentleman who our chairman's just mentioned, a gentleman by the name of Tommy Rockwell, who was the A&R and talent scout for Okeh Records, got hold of Willie Narmore and got him to record in Memphis in 1928. And he asked Willie Narmore, do you know of any black musicians around Avalon who would be good enough to record? And Willie immediately mentioned John Hurt and said, why don't we go round to John's place, have him play a few tunes and see if he's good enough to record? And in fact, that's what happened. This is the kind of music that... This is the kind of music that Willie Narmore and Shel Smith played. It's called Carroll County Blues. I just love that fiddle music, wonderful stuff. So John was listening to a whole lot of different kinds of music, including blues, and really John Hurt wasn't a blues man. He did do some blues songs, but what the Okeh Record Company did was to tag on the word blues to many, many of the tunes that John recorded. They weren't actually blues at all, but it was all a sales ploy, that if you tagged on the end of blues, so Stackerly, which was really a murder ballad, became Stackerly Blues and so on. This is an interesting little story. I got to know about the recording session in Memphis, and for many years I'd talked to a lot of people and I could not track down where these recordings took place. There were no real recording studios or permanent recording studios in Memphis at that time, and most were recorded in the so-called field sessions in hotels or showrooms or furniture stores or whatever. And it wasn't until I was tracking through microfiche copies of the Memphis Commercial Appeal newspaper that it was one of these eureka moments for researchers that I suddenly found the name Rockwell in this advert, and right in the bottom left corner there, the McCall Building. And this is the place where many of those musicians went and recorded in Memphis, Tennessee. The McCall Building, which sadly is no longer there. It was knocked down in the Beale Street Renewal Project and is now a parking lot, but at least we know where it was. Of course, Tommy Rockwell, very famous man, I've been corresponding with his son Michael, in fact, in doing some more work looking at the life story of some of these people, like Tommy Rockwell. And Tommy Rockwell also was responsible, or very closely connected, with the Louis Armstrong Hot 5 recordings at around the same time. This is an advert of the Okeh company in 1929. And you can, interestingly, you can see Mississippi John Hart, they got the name wrong. And this is the advertisement for the first, well, the only release that was made following that Memphis session. Several recordings were made, only this one was released, and it was Frankie, John's version of the murder ballad of Frankie and Albert. This is this very distinctive style of John Hurt's. And you can see that John was in good company at that time. He, Victoria Spivey, Walter Beasley, and the Louis Armstrong Orchestra on the same album.
He's a man, and he done it wrong.
Just one man on a guitar.
Bring me down to the corner.
Quite incredible, just one man on a guitar doing that stuff. That was a huge success for John. It probably sold numbers of records in the thousands, and it was just, it just got in ahead of the Great Depression. It sold well, and as a result of it selling well, Tommy Rockwell wrote a letter to John in early 1929 and early 28, sorry, and suggested that John come to New York to the Okeh Studios there to lay down some more recordings, which John did, and in December 1928, a whole lot more, well, another five recordings were made, and they were all released. This one, Candyman Blues, was released in early 1929.
All your ladies all gather round, that good sweet candy man in town is the candy man, is the candy man. Just 9 8 long. He sells his fast and hog and chew his cone. It's the candy man. It's the candy man.
Candyman Blues. Well, what happened next was very unfortunate. The Great Depression came in. The records didn't sell as well as the first one. And as they released the next six titles through 1929 and into 1930, sales got worse and worse and worse, and they were just selling a few hundreds. And John Hurt never ever heard from Tommy Rockwell or the Okeh Recording Company again. And his short-lived career as a musician appeared to be over. It was actually not quite over, it was delayed for about 30 years. But John carried on playing music. This is him outside of Stinson's store on Highway 7 between Grenada and Greenwood, Mississippi. He would play for local parties, but he never ever appeared in front of any sizable audiences. The next kind of milestone in the career of John Hurt, which John was completely unaware of, was that folk collector Harry Smith, who'd got a lot of rare recordings, including a few of John Hurt, amassed this great anthology of American folk music. There were two recordings from John's early 1928 records put out on the anthology. And the thing that the anthology did, of course, was to make this music accessible to a huge lot of people. Spike Driver Blues.
Captain, tell him I'm gone. Tell him him I'm gone. Tell him I'm gone.
And of course, Spike Driver Blues was again John's own take on the familiar story of John Henry. Well, what was going on in the late 50s into the early 60s was there's a huge interest being taken and a huge upsurge in interest in the folk blues, particularly down the East Coast in Washington, D.C. and New York around Greenwich Village. And the Harry Smith anthology had, as I say, made a lot of this music accessible to people. One of those folk was this guy named Tom Hoskins. Tom was a kind of a bit of a hippie character, very fond of alcohol, girls, and drugs, in no particular order, but alongside seemed to me to have been a hell of a nice guy. I sadly never met Tom Hoskins. He died a few years back. But Tom was very interested in this kind of music, particularly John Hurt, and him and a number of his associates were trying to play the stuff from listening to Harry Smith's anthology. And by all accounts, Tom Hoskins was rather good at it. Well, the last recording to be released in early 1930 from these OK sessions in New York City was a tune called Avalon Blues. Here we see this blues tag again being added to this record. This is the rarest of all of the 78 recordings. And it wasn't until probably late 1962, early 1963, that Tom Hoskins actually heard a tape recording of this. He didn't have the record, but it was the first time he'd heard Avalon Blues. And I've just put the words across. As you listen to the tune, just have a listen for these words.
In New York this morning, just about 9:30. Out in New York this morning, just about 9:30. Thought of my morning album, couldn't hardly keep from crying. Avalon, my hometown, always on my mind. Avalon, my hometown, always on my mind. Pretty Mars and Avalon want me there all the time.
Pretty Mamas in Avalon want me there all the time. Tom heard this and said, Eureka, he's telling me where he lives. Avalon, Mississippi John Hurt. Is there a place called Avalon in Mississippi? And at the time, several of these guys have been talking to one another and saying, I wonder if any of these guys are actually still alive. And could they be found? Could we locate them? And the general feeling at the time was they were probably mostly dead. Anyway, John, cut a long story short, Tom Hoskins discovered a place called Avalon between Grenada and Greenwood on a map of Mississippi, jumped in his old Volkswagen car and headed off down there with just about enough money to pay for the fuel. He got down to Stinson's store on Highway 7 and asked the guy at the gas pumps, did anyone around here ever heard of a guy called Mississippi John Hurt, who made records back in the 1920s? And he was blown away by the answer. The guy pointed up, he said, follow the dirt road over there, past the country store, third mailbox on the left, that's John's house. He couldn't believe it. So off he went, and this is the picture of the country store with Tom Hoskins writing across the top. The grocery store near John's house above Avalon, Mississippi, and his old car outside. He couldn't believe his luck. He carried on down the road and met a whole lot of people who showed him where the house was. This is Mississippi John Hurt in the middle with Hillman Moreland, the storekeeper, and two of John's relatives. This is John's house in Avalon with the caption, as again written by Tom Hoskins. And very soon, the family had gathered, and this is them taken by Tom in front of the house. This was all happening on March the 2nd of 1963, just over 50 years to the day. So we're really celebrating this year, 50 years since John Hurt's rediscovery. Well, luckily, Tom had brought with him an Ampex tape recorder, because he knew fine if he did find John Hurt, nobody was going to believe him, unless he'd got some good evidence. So, he went into the house with the recorder, he got it set up, and he made a one-hour tape. And this is the box that the tape was in. I'll tell you a little story about this. This was the box, and on it, in his own handwriting, he'd written the word discovery. This was another of these incredible eureka moments. I'd been trying to find more about Tom Hurt and Tom Hoskins, and I knew that he'd made this recording, as did many other people, but we all assumed, especially with Tom's lifestyle, that he had no fixed abode, he just bummed around from place to place. He didn't have any material possessions except a guitar and a few things, and everybody assumed that these recordings had gone missing. Tom had died, and I met, fortunately, tracked down his sister Suzanne in Atlanta, Georgia, in 2007. And I thought she'll be able to tell me lots of stuff about her brother, her younger brother, Tommy. Well, I went to her house and we sat down, and it was all a little bit disappointing, because she then announced to me that actually her husband was in the military and they were in Germany when Tom made this amazing rediscovery of John Hurt, and she really couldn't tell me much about it. She did give me a lot of background stuff about her brother, but I was kind of a little bit disappointed. I switched my little digital recorder off, having finished the interview, and she said, "Oh, by the way, under your bed in the spare bedroom is an old box with stuff in it that Tom had. I've never really bothered to look through it. You're welcome to take a look through if you like." Well, I couldn't wait to get up the stairs, as you can imagine. And in this box were posters and all sorts of memorabilia about John Hurt. And right at the bottom, in a cardboard, but in a plastic bag, I felt this tape box, and written on it the word discovery. And this was the tape of that session in 1963, the first recording made of John Hurt since 1928. And I just want to see if you can listen to this. These are the words. This is the very beginning of this tape.
Testing 1, 2, 3.
Listen to this. That was the first thing he played. It was a cow called Cow Hooking Blues, and that was Jesse, his wife, saying, "John, you better make the most of this." In other words, there might be some money in this. At last, you might be going to make some money from your ability to play this stuff. So they were very soon into the house, and they gathered round, and they had a real hootenanny in there.
I'll start it off.
You could hear Jesse there. When John forgot the words, Jesse would fill in, and they had a great time. And it's all on this record, on this this one-hour tape. And I had the good fortune of meeting up with various folk who were in the business, and again, cut a long story short, we were able to record all the highlights from that Hoskins tape onto this CD, which we call Discovery, The Rebirth of Mississippi John Hurt. And that's available from Springfed Records. It's got all of this stuff on there, lots of conversation as well as music, and roosters calling in the background. It's just a wonderful historic recording. At about the time, Tom Hoskins also got John to write down the story of his life. He wrote it on 3 pages. I've just put the last page on here. It's in my book, the whole thing. But I thought this was an interesting little characteristic of John, which demonstrates what kind of man he was. He was an extremely modest man. And he's put here, also worked some on the IC, that was the Illinois Central Railroad, and on the WPA project. I'm now on the road again with the Piedmont Record Company, hoping to make a success. Mississippi John Hurt. Well, for him to say, you know, hoping to make a success was incredibly modest. And of course, he did go on and became a great success for 3 years from 1963. He was very soon ensconced in a place called the Ontario Place.
C.C. Ryan.
This is in Washington, D.C. That was the first song that John sang at the Newport Folk Festival in 1963, when he was in the company of such people as Joan Baez and John and Bob Dylan, amongst others. And it was the first time that he appeared with any kind of size of an audience. Remember, all he'd ever done before was make the recordings in Memphis and play a few tunes locally. And suddenly he was pushed on stage in front of 18,000 people. And Dick Spotswood and Tom Hoskins at the time suddenly looked at one another and thought, can John handle this? We've never even thought about it. And here he is, and he was pushed on stage. And of course, John was completely relaxed. And within half a minute or so, he had the audience eaten out of his hand. So the next thing was to make some recordings. And the very first recording that was made was this one, Folk Songs and Blues, which Hoskins and Dick Spotswood, who many of you know, got him to record on this their own label, the Piedmont label. And you'll see this is an autographed copy of this record that John gave to Tom Hoskins, and subsequently Tom's sister, Suzanne, presented to me on my birthday a couple of years ago. So that was a wonderful memento to have. So anyway, I continued to do the research on the book and track down things. And on the back of that Piedmont record on the vinyl, the credits said the chief engineer was a man called Peter Sillich. So I wondered to myself, well, I wonder, is he still around? He'd be a good guy to talk to. Cut a long story short again, I tracked him down and found him alive and well, a wonderful man living in the hills of West Virginia. And I was soon on the phone and up there to meet him, and he was a wonderful host. And a kind of similar story to Suzanne. We sat and talked about the sessions. He gave me lots of wonderful information about John. And at the end of the session, he went off to another room and came back with a big cardboard box full of tapes. And
angels laid him away. Angels laid him away.
This was a tune that he'd recorded back in 1928 called Lewis Collins. And I want you to just, this is the conversation, because what Peter Sillich had done.
Is that a true song? I mean, you know who it's about?
Have a listen to this.
Lewis Collins.
Follow the dialogue.
I mean, somebody from around Avalon or anything like that?
No, sir, he wasn't from around Avalon, but, I can't commit it to remember just where he was from. But, let's see, Lewis shot once and Bob shot two. Shot four, Collins, I didn't even do. Lewis, he's a pretty tough guy. But Bob was a little tough.
Yeah.
He shot at Bob once. Bob shot him twice. Hit him both times. Mm-hmm. Shot him through and through.
But it was a true story.
Huh? It's a true story, yes, sir.
Where did that
true
happen?
Story.
You know?
What's that?
Where did that happen? They shot each other.
Let me see the place, if I can say the name.
Was that some big city or something?
That's right.
Yeah. Was Memphis, maybe? St. Louis?
I think it was Memphis. I think that's where it was, Memphis.
We're running a little bit short of time, so I'm going to just skip on here. But the interesting thing there was that I just felt like giving a smack to Tom Hoskins, because just as he was getting some of the information there, he very bad interview, he gave the leading question and said to John, was it Memphis or was it St. Louis? And of course, John responded because he couldn't quite think where it was and said, oh yeah, I think it was Memphis. I just wish Tom had not said anything and we might have known where that murder took place. Anyway, this is a slight digression, so I'm just going to skip over this. But I did find out that that murder probably took place in West Virginia, because that's where I found a Lewis Collins. It was a black and white murder, which hit the national press big time, just before 1928, when John made the recordings. I'm just winding up now. John finished his career, moved back to Grenada about 6 months before he passed away. And this is him on the front porch of his house in Grenada. And I just want to tell you a little story, because the man had so much wit, and if I had more time, I could go on and on for hours and tell you funny story about John. One that I really liked particularly, Gene Bush, who had met him in Cincinnati at a concert, became friendly with John and went down to see him in Grenada. And one time John was coughing very badly. He was a heavy smoker and he had bronchitis. And he said to John, John, you really should stop this smoking. You should go and see the doctor and get something done about this. To which John responded and said, yeah, well, I did go and see the doctor. And the doctor said, John, you know, you should really give up those camels. And as he was doing so, he took a cigarette out and lit it. And Gene said, well, John, if you had that advice from the doctor, why are you lighting another cigarette? To which John replied, well, he never said nothing about palmettos. So that kind of says what he was like. Final thoughts. His biography provides a lot of information on life in rural Mississippi. I think I've shown that the wealth of Mississippi John Hurt's music has been supplemented enormously by recordings of conversations as well. This kind of information can add to our knowledge of the social history and the context of the musicians, and I believe is as important, every bit as important, as the music itself. So we shouldn't squander opportunities to gain an insight into the social fabric of the musicians that we admire so much by making sure that we also engage them in conversation as well as by listening to their music. Thank you very much.